I only know it his right hand. Stands one who is my Savior. I take him at his word and deed. Christ died to save me, this I read. And in my heart I find a need of him to be my Savior. That he would leave his place on high and come for sinful men to die. You counted strange, so once did I. Before I knew my Savior, my Savior loves, my Savior lives, my Savior's always there for me. My God, he was, my God, he is, my God is always gonna be. My Savior loves, my Savior lives, my Savior's always there for me. My God, he was, my God, he is, my God is always gonna be. Yes, living, dying, let me breathe. My strength, my soul is from the spring. That he who lives to be my king once died to be my Savior. That he would leave his place on high and come for sinful men to die. You count it strange, so once did I. Before I knew my Savior. My Savior loves, my Savior lives, my Savior's always there for me. My God, he was, my God, he is, my God is always gonna be. My Savior loves, my Savior lives, my Savior's always there for me. My God, he was, my God, he is, my God is always gonna be. I'm not skilled to understand what God has willed, what God has planned. I only know it his right hand. Stands one who is my Savior.
To the prison I've worn. shackles and chains. But I've been freed and forgiven. I'm not going back. I'll never be the same. So sing with me.
All my hope is in Jesus. Thank God that yesterday's gone. And all my sins are forgiven. I've been washed by blood.
Some kind of thing that just breaks a man. It breaks him right down to his knees. God, I've been broken more than a time or two. Then he picked me up, showed me how to be a man. So I said,
all my hope is in Jesus. Thank God that yesterday's gone.
Thank you. shame. Lord of our sinful hearts, He is our great Redeemer. Sing to Jesus, honor His name. Sing to Jesus, Jesus is our throne.
Good morning. Isn't that a beautiful song? Didn't he do a really, the two yes. of them did a great job, yeah. Welcome to First Christian Church. I hear it's going to be a beautiful day today, so thank you for coming. You have on your tables, or you had in your chairs, some little yellow slips of paper. Just want to remind you that if you have a prayer concern, feel free to fill those out and drop them in the baskets. Also, if you are a visitor with us today, we'd love to know more about you, so feel free to fill those out and drop them in the baskets with whatever information you want us to have. Easter is coming up soon. Yay? Yeah. Amen. So we're going to have a special service on Maundy Thursday. It's called The Art and Music of the Passion, and we're going to be viewing paintings and listening to music that tell the story of Christ's death and resurrection. So I hope to see you all there. It's going to be Maundy Thursday, April 18th, starting at 6 o'clock. At this time, I would ask the children, all the children under the age of 8, which she may have them, right? Y'all need to come, yeah. All the children under the age of 8, if you'll go with Miss Jillian to children's worship. Now, we're going to pep it up a little bit now. So I need y'all to stand up. Get your clapping and your moving around stuff on. And we're going to get our praise on with Thrive.
Whoa.
Planted by the water, we never will run dry. So
Like you mean it.
Yeah.
When darkness tries to roll over my bones, when sorrow comes to steal the joy I am, and when brokenness and pain is all I know, oh, I won't be shaken, oh, I won't be shaken. And my fear doesn't stand a chance. chance when I stand in your love. My fear, it doesn't stand a chance when I stand in your love. My fear, it doesn't stand a chance when I stand in your love. Shame no longer has a place to hide, and I am not a captive to the lies. Oh, I'm not afraid to leave my past behind. Oh, I won't be shaken. No, I won't be shaken. My fear doesn't stand a chance when I stand your love. My fear, it doesn't stand a chance when I stand in your love. My fear, it doesn't stand a chance when I stand in your love. There's power that can break off every chain. There's power that can empty out a grave. Resurrection power that can save. There's power in your name, power in your name. There's power that can break off every chain. There's power that can empty out a grave. There's resurrection power that can save. Power in your name, there's power in your name. My fear doesn't stand a chance when I stand in your love. My fear, it doesn't stand a chance when I stand in your love. My fear, it doesn't stand a chance when I stand in your love. My fear doesn't stand a chance when I stand in your love. My fear, it doesn't stand a chance when I stand in your love. My fear, it doesn't stand a chance when I stand in your
Good morning. Good to see you all this morning. I was thinking as I was preparing and anticipating this service this Sunday that so many of us are in different places on our faith journey. For some of us, we are here this morning for the first time. You heard a little bit about First Christian Church of Washington, thought you would check it out for yourselves. Some of you got roped into coming here this morning, probably somewhere else you would rather be. Some of you are here because there's no place you would rather be. For some of us, we wonder about who this Jesus is, who God is. Is this stuff for real? Is this something that's a part of our imagination? Is it something that was really a human development some 2,000 years ago that was a new development based on an older development, and people have just passed it down orally and through literature, and really it's all nonsense? Some of us may have that question, and that's a good question to have. For some of us, we've encountered God in such a way that we could say it was like a born-again experience. The people we were is no longer the people we are. After we've encountered God with one of those self-authenticating spiritual experiences, as one theologian described it, we know that our lives will never be the same. Regardless of where we are on our spiritual journey, I want you to know that each and every person here is welcome. Who is welcome here, church? Everyone is welcome here. We are all children of God. We all have infinite dignity and worth, and we're going to hear a little bit more about that in just a few moments, but I want you to know with my whole heart, with everything I am, you are welcome here, and you are exactly where you are supposed to be. Whether you realize it or not, this is a divine appointment, and I pray that for every one of us, our lives will not be the same, that the people we were when we walked in will not be the person we'll be when we walk out, that our lives will be touched, we'll have a renewed sense of purpose, we'll have a renewed sense of meaning, we'll have a renewed sense of hope and joy, a renewed sense of confidence, recognizing that all of that is rooted in the ultimate reality. The ultimate reality is God, and the ultimate reality of God is that God is love. With that in mind, there are a couple of announcements that I have to share with you. We have a couple of baptisms that are going to be taking place at the next service, Matthew and Austin. That'll happen at the very beginning of the next service. If there are some of you who would like to be a part of that, you're welcome to do so. And people understand sometimes there are late service people who come to this service and early service people who go to the late service, and it's no issue if you just want to be there for the baptism and then see your way out because you've been to a worship experience. We certainly understand that. Now I want you to pause for just a moment. Take a little bit of a breath. What I'm getting ready to share with you is part of the paradoxical nature of our faith walk. And by that I mean, when we are people of faith, our love intensifies. And when our love intensifies, our grief, the level of feeling of our grief intensifies. And yet in the midst of that, our hope intensifies when we are in God. So I want to share with you, and I know this will come as unwelcome news in one sense, but as a celebration in another. Laurie Cullip went home to be with God last night. She had been suffering for a little while, and she has transitioned. Now hear me, this is not an empty statement. She has transitioned from this life to life beyond our imagining, where nothing is broken, nothing is missing, everything is whole. Do you hear me? This is a day of grief for us because of the intensity of our love. We feel that grief, even to a greater degree. But also because of our faith that is rooted in the ultimate reality, we have assurance, we have confidence, and we have hope. We say each week, and it's important in times like this, that it's important that our faith is developing over time, because if we just land one day when we face a circumstance that's beyond our control, that's devastating to us, if we haven't been prepared along the way, then it'll be even more devastating. And when we have a solid faith, nothing is ultimately devastating. So I want to repeat to you something we often say so that we can internalize this, so that whenever we come to that day, and every one of us in this room will have a day where what we're facing is beyond our personal resources to deal with it, our own individual resources to deal with it. In our own power, we cannot deal with it. But this is what I want us to remind everyone of, including myself. On our own, we don't have the power to deal with life. But we're not on our own. God really is with us. God really is with us. God's Spirit really is with us. Our hope is not a wish. Our hope is rooted in our faith, and our faith is rooted in the ultimate reality. That reality is what is really real. It is true, objectively so. It is true. It's not subjective. The reality of God is true. It is real. We can know that, and once we know that, then we have the confidence. That's what faith is. With faith, confidence. With fide, with faith. And our hope is rooted in that faith. Are you with me? Let the church say, amen. Let's go to God in prayer together. Gracious God, we thank you for every person in this room. We thank you that we are here not by accident or coincidence. You knew the very seat that we would sit in this morning. Now we know that you don't cause all things. You're not the cause of our suffering. You're not the cause of our loss. You're not the cause of unfortunate circumstances. But we know that you can cause all things to work for good. So therein lies our confidence. Therein lies our security. We know that even within ourselves, we go different paths. We know that even when we intend to do your will, we miss it. Sometimes we knowingly, willfully, go on a path other than you would desire for us. But we come to this place this morning and we remember as you have challenged, encouraged, invited us to do, we remember that your love really is unconditional, that we've done nothing to earn your love, we'll do nothing to lose your love, that your love is infinite. God, we are here in different places and stations and seasons of life, and you know exactly where we are. We're here to entrust ourselves to you. We're here to want to trust you. For those of us who do not yet know what that means. And so for all of us, wherever we are on our journey, we ask that you would assist us, encourage us, empower us, help us to open our hearts and minds, not with the platitude, not with the superstition, not with touchy-feely, warm feelings. We love that we experience you and we feel you, but we want to know you. We want to know you beyond our understanding. We want to encounter you. We want a firsthand, not a secondhand relationship with you. We love that other people have shared their experiences with us, but we want an experience for ourselves. Many of us come with questions and doubts. We thank you that you can handle our questions. We thank you that you can handle our doubts. Some of us are here because we're at the end of our own personal resources. We pray that we would be reminded that we are not on our own, that you are with us, that you've given us a community of faith. With those that we walk this path of discipleship, there is no burden that is too heavy for us to bear because we don't have to bear it on our own. You've given us this community. We pray that as we continue with our service, that you would direct our minds and our hearts, that you would fill our spirits, that we would be drawn closer to you and closer to one another, that we would grow in the peace and the joy and the wholeness and the meaning and the purpose that you desire for each and every one of us. This we ask in the name of the one who revealed your unconditional love, the one who taught us, and the one who showed us the way to draw closer to you and one another, even through the gift of prayer, the one that he taught us when he said, "Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen." I'd like to invite those who are serving to come forward at this time.
Good morning. I'd like to welcome everybody once again to this part of the service. Newcomers, we've got a candle at the back. Christ is the light of the world. It's special. We've got people that's interested in praying with you. If you've got any burdens or anything like that, it's the time to light a candle and reflect on what's on our heart, what's on somebody else's heart, and wherever we're at in life. Let Christ know that he's with us. Because in today's scriptures, glance through it and look through it and memorize them and everything. Jacob calls us, and also God calls us to be children of God, and we are children of God. But without that, we're also in Christ, and in Christ is a position that we have in this time of the year as Christ is walking to his death, to the cross, toting his own cross. We're also told to pick up our cross and follow him, you know, and that's a weekly, daily, hour struggle in our lives. Not only mine, but everybody's. And we have tables off to the left and to the right. If you'd like to be served, you can come down the center aisle and be served. And we also have baskets off to the side of it. You don't pay for what this is. This is a gift. A gift is what God has given us. And when we give and God gives these gifts, it's a gift to open it. At Christmas time, we open up presents. That's a gift. Well, God has given us a free gift of grace and the mercy. And every day that we go through life, every breath that we take is a gift of God. And, you know, we can't pay for his love. You know, it's already given to us. All we have to do is be reconciled back into him and understand that he has done something for us that we can't pay for. But being that said, let us go to God in prayer. Father God, this is a special time of the year. You've given us a son, your son to us to wash away our sins, our burdens, step into a different life, an exchanged life, a renewed life. Lord, we just thank you for the bread representing the body and the wine, spilt blood. Lord, we just thank you for each day that's given to us. I ask that everyone here remembers that time of year over 2,000 years ago, from now and evermore. In Jesus Christ we pray. Amen. On that night when Jesus was getting ready to be betrayed, he sat around with his disciples, and he looked at each one of them and said, "This is my body." Is broken for me and you. Take this in remembrance of me. In like manner, this spilt blood says, "This is the blood of a new covenant. Do this in remembrance of me." This is the gift of God for the people of God.
Thank you.
every week. They're something, aren't they? My goodness. You would think with familiarity it would just get common, but it's never common. It's always an extraordinary experience, so we are truly grateful for all of you. We are wrapping up in some ways a series. It's been a common theme, but it's not cumulative. Each message in many ways can stand on its own, and in other ways they're interconnected. And we have been discussing our journey of faith, which we have called becoming. We are all in the process of becoming. Whether we recognize it or not, we are in the process. For some of us, we would say, well, I've been in the same place for a long time. No, you've been in the process of solidifying where you are. But that, too, is a process, well, which may make it more difficult at that point where we become intentional about the process of our journey, and that journey in particular that we're discussing this morning and for the last several weeks, and really every week that we gather, is this process of transformation, this process of becoming who we were truly created to be. For those of you who are here for the first time, we are in the season of Lent. Lent literally means lengthening of days. It is often associated with spring, but it also reflects the time that Jesus was in the wilderness. For some of you, you're aware of that story. For others, you are not. And I love that as we gather in this room, we are in all kinds of different places in our journey of faith. And so we never take it for granted that we are familiar with some of these stories. But Luke, in particular, accounts that Jesus was led by the Spirit into the wilderness where for 40 days and 40 nights he was tempted. I believe he was getting very clear about what his mission was going to be. I believe that a lot of the temptations were to distract him about what he was called to do with his particular life. But after 40 days and 40 nights, he then began his ministry and he came announcing what that would mean. And we know that it was all-encompassing. That his mission is all-encompassing, and it affects every realm of life. It is not a matter of belief merely. It is not a matter of a church institution. It is not a matter of a religion, unless that religion can point us to the way that he was calling us to. He came announcing in word and deed what he referred to as the kingdom of God. Now, for us in the 21st century, that language is in some ways obsolete. What do we mean by the kingdom of God? We don't think of kingdoms very often in the 21st century. He was talking about a reign, a rule, that which is operative, that which is the highest authority. And when he came announcing the kingdom of God, he was saying the highest authority is love. Now, we're not going to talk too much in detail about love, but when I use that word, I want you to know that I'm not talking merely about what we feel when we talk about love. We're talking about the highest reality that there is. And he said the kingdom of God is where love is operative in every realm of life within ourselves, our relationship to God, our relationship to one another. And in just a few moments, we're going to look at this word reconciliation that in some ways gets at this word love, this reality of love that we're talking about. So during this time, we recognize that Jesus came announcing that in word, but also in deed. And love, the kind of love that he was talking about, is the love that is a sacrificial love. A love that loves people so much that he was willing to do anything to demonstrate God's love for all of us, which in his earthly life came to the most intense confrontation with the cross. And I'm going to pause just for a moment to say a couple of words about the cross because I always feel like it's important to. Many of us understand the cross in different ways. I would submit this to you, and I invite you to get into a small group where we can discuss this more at length, but for our time being, you often hear me say, God does not cause all things, but God can cause all things to work for good. I do not believe that God desired the cross. God has no need for punishment. Punishment is not a demonstration of God's love. Jesus was the embodiment of God's love. God did not crucify Jesus. People crucified Jesus. People who had lost their way, people who misunderstood, people who were otherwise faithful and pious to the best of their ability, did not recognize what God in the flesh looks like. And that powerful statement that came from Jesus that literally gives me chills as I talk about it, is Jesus, after The world, the people who were misdirected had thrown everything they could at him. He says, Father, forgive them. They know not what they do. That is the love of God. That's what we're talking about. And that's what we're called to be about during this season. Now, I want us to talk for a few moments about being born again. How many of you have ever heard of born again Christians? And how do we understand what it means to be a born again Christian? Sometimes we understand it in this way. To be a born again Christian means that this is how some people understand it. Mine is not quite consistent with this, and I'll share with you a common understanding. And for those of you who hold this understanding, that's one of the beautiful things about us as the Christian Church Disciples of Christ. Where two or more are gathered in Jesus' name, they will disagree about what that means. So you can disagree, and that's okay, and come talk to me, and I'd love to hear from you, and I am always open, and people who know me know this, I am always open that you may correct my perspective, and I am certainly open to that. And I'll probably come back next week and tell the whole church about how you corrected my perspective. I'm serious. I'm a student on this journey just like you are. I have some convictions after a lot of thought and study and prayer and dialogue and reflection. And this is where I have come to the place where I understand being born again, but I want to share with you a common understanding of being born again. Some people understand that we were born into sin and we are sinful by nature, as they understand it, by nature. And that at some point, we will have heard the good news of Jesus Christ. And that good news is that if we accept him as our Savior, that we are forgiven of our sin and sins, and that we are born again, we now become children of God. Once we have received Jesus as our Lord and Savior, now we are children of God. Does that sound fairly consistent with people? I don't see it exactly that way. And again, disagree with me, that's okay. And we can passionately disagree, but I won't be as passionate in my disagreement if you disagree with me. But you can be just as passionate as you want, and honestly, I'll respond as temperate and measured as I can. I believe we are all children of God created in God's image. I believe we are all children of God created in God's image. I believe that our nature is that we are children of God. But we also have a condition. And our condition is in conflict with our true nature. I believe that there is a process for some children at a very early age, babies. We see what I believe the imprint of the divine nature even in children. How many small children are racist before they're taught to be racist? There, we could go on and on about the kinds of things that we as adults instill in these children, and many of us consider ourselves born-again Christians, which doesn't reflect so much to me what a child of God should be like. So for time's sake, I'm not going to point out every one of these things that we often instill in our children. Sometimes unaware because someone instilled it in us. But we have a nature and we have a condition. At some point, all of us begin to, for some people it's gradual. For some people there's a moment where you realize now God's love is real. And when you do, when you've had that kind of experience, you realize that God's love was always real. God's love for you was always real. It was always there. So by the way of testimony, if you've never had one of these experiences, it's okay. It's not the measure of your spirituality or whether or not you're a child of God. I happen to be able to point to a day and a time. It was Easter Sunday, 1996, and it wasn't in a church, and it doesn't matter what the experience was. What matters is the one I experienced. And in that moment, with all of my skepticism up until that point, and I wasn't reared in the church, and I had some questions that I thought were too big for God because I was just so smart. And Christianity just did not add up. I mean, only people who are anti-intellectual could truly be a Christian. And I gave God what I thought was my best theological conundrum. And then all of a sudden God said, here I am. And this was the experience. I love you with an absolutely unconditional love. I have always loved you with an unconditional love. Back then when you wondered, yes, that was me. Back then when you had that experience, yes, that was me. That time, you were always with me. I was always with you. I will always be with you. When you've encountered that kind of love, now all of a sudden you realize who you are and who you were always created to be. We were born to know the love of God. That's why we were born. That's why we exist. That's the whole meaning and purpose of this life. It's to know that we are children of God, loved with an absolutely unconditional love. We will never, ever, 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 ever lose the love of God. It is ours. Whatever we've done, it's forgiven. Whatever we're going to do, it's forgiven. We are loved with an infinite love. And once we see that, in a sense, we're born again, but we're born into who we were always created to be. That's my sense of it. Are you with me? Once that happens, then the process begins. There's no way I'm going to have time to go to all these passages. I want you to look at them on your own, okay? Look at Nicodemus. He comes to Jesus in the night and says, "Surely these things that you're doing, you have to be from God." It's interesting, Jesus turns the conversation to about the kingdom of God. Jesus was preoccupied with the kingdom of God. He was always preoccupied with the kingdom of God. Then he says, "You must be born from above." That's interesting. You must be born from above. What does it mean to be born from above? Look at 1 John chapter 4, verse 7. Those who love are born of God. Why? Because God is love. For those of us who are tired of talking about love, let me tell you something. Then we're tired of talking about God. Why? God is what? The more we know about love, the more we know about God. For those of us who know love, we can't talk about it enough. We can't grow in it enough. Once we recognize, though, so this born-again experience, at some point we will make a choice. It becomes intentional. And now we've made a choice. We are turning away. Make no mistake, there is a part of our condition that is tugging at our spirits. And that's the reason I wanted you to look at Galatians. There is a conflict with our condition and our nature. Our nature is that we're children of God. There's a conflict. It's in every one of us. For some of us, we're pursuing more of this and more of that. We're trying to fill that insatiable desire within us. And sometimes it's easier. It's easier for me. I'll do it before this day is over, and most likely you will too. There are times that there are conflicts. We want more of God. God is the source of our life. How many of you sometimes grab a Twinkie when you need a salad? They even make Twinkies anymore? They went away for a while, didn't they? And people were in an outrage. They had to bring them back. But how many times do we do that? We know we need this, but I want this because this will fix it now. We all do it. You do it, I do it. Here's the good news. We are forgiven. Now, some people say once you get a hold of God's grace, you'll just have a license to do anything. No, you won't. No, you won't. When you have a true understanding of God's grace, it is God's grace that'll constrain you from doing those things. Now you no longer do it because you're not afraid that God's going to get you. That's no longer why we don't do things. God will get me if I mess up. Boy, God is keeping score, and I'm in trouble now. What happens when you've done so much now you feel like you're beyond God's reach? That vicious cycle. I'm out of God's love. I'm in pain. I'm estranged. I'm empty. I need more of whatever it was, and it's a vicious cycle. What happens when you encounter God's love? You want more of that love, and now God's love is in you, and now you're finding yourself to where it's not because you're afraid of the consequences in terms of God's going to get you. You want more of God. Now, here's the other thing. Now, this is something to understand. Truly go back and look at that Galatians text, because what Paul is going to say is those who do these things, and he has a laundry list of these things we're not supposed to do, will not inherit the kingdom of God. This is the process I want us to understand. We are living in the kingdom of God, and we are growing in the kingdom of God. When we do these things, we are not inheriting the kingdom of God. There are certain things that we can do in our lives that are not actually life-giving. So this is not a moralism. It's not a matter of whether you are good or you are bad. If you do this, you're a bad person. If you do this, you're a good person. That's not the way we need to understand this. The way we need to understand this is these things will lead to life. These things will lead to wholeness. These things will lead to fullness. These things will lead to joy. These things will lead to pain. These things will lead to conflict. These things will lead to interpersonal schisms in our relationships. These things will end up leaving us empty. Do you see the difference? It's an inspiration that we want to live this way. It's not a matter of whether you're good or bad. What is our true nature? Who are we? Children of God. Once we realize that, we're acting in accordance with our nature. We are born to see God as God is. Now, let's look at these passages very quickly. We're going to read through them. As many of you as, this is Galatians chapter 3, 27, 28. As many of you as were baptized into Christ have clothed yourself with Christ. There is no longer Jew or Greek. There is no longer slave or free. There is no longer male and female. For all of you are what? One in Christ Jesus. Now let's look at 2 Corinthians. From now on, therefore, we regard no one from a human point of view. Now, I have said our human nature is what? Children of God and love. This is interesting, and this is something, this is where for many of you we need to do Bible studies, because we grow in our understanding of things and we get to the point to where we can actually have a conversation with the translator of a particular passage, and a translator is always an interpreter. Did you hear me? Translators are always making choices, and in their choices they're revealing their interpretation, not just their translation. That word is for the Greek word flesh. Isn't that interesting? The translators, the interpreters, associate being human with our condition rather than our nature. So this would have better read from a fleshly point of view. What is by flesh? Our flesh is not bad. Did God create our flesh? Our flesh is good. So what do we mean by flesh? Those appetites, those desires, those wills that are apart from the will of God, that are not actually life-giving but will diminish the life in ourselves and others. That's what they mean by fleshly. There's nothing wrong with our flesh. God created our flesh, and our flesh is good. I ran through that quickly. Is everyone with me? Is everyone with me? From now on, therefore, regard no one from a fleshly point of view, even though we once knew Christ from a fleshly point of view. We know him no longer in that way. So if anyone is in Christ Jesus, there is a new creation. Everything old has passed away. See, everything has become new. How many of you want an experience that you encounter God's love in such a way that you say, my goodness, everything is new? I don't look at my spouse. I don't look at my children. I don't look at this world. I don't look at the church. I don't look at my future. I don't look at my past. I don't look at the circumstances. I don't look at anything the way I used to look at it. Now that I have encountered the love of God, how many of you want that experience? Now you know who you truly are. You are a new creation in the sense of you are now who you were always created to be. You were born for this. All this is from God, who reconciled us to himself through Christ. Watch how many times he talks about reconciliation. All this is from God, who reconciled us to himself through Christ and has given us the ministry of reconciliation. Jane Worsley, the other day, we were in a small group, said, what a risk God has taken on us. Laugh, as we all did. Now ponder that. Let's listen to how it's stated even further. That is, in Christ, God was reconciling the world to himself, not counting their trespasses against them, and entrusting the message of reconciliation to us. God has entrusted the message of reconciliation to us. So we are ambassadors for Christ. Since God is making his appeal through us, we entreat you on behalf of Christ, be reconciled to God. Once we have this sense, wherever it starts, whether it's a powerful emotional experience or not, but that day that we recognize, I am a child of God, that's who I am, the process begins, and we are in the process of becoming who we truly are. We begin to see as God sees. I could have said we begin to know, but Paul says we knew Christ from a human point of view. We begin to see things as God sees them. We see who Jesus is. We see who God is, from a divine perspective. Now, for many of us, we struggle with that. We struggle to see who Jesus is. Jesus was 2,000 years ago. What does that mean? Focus on Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. Recognize that there are some differences. And for time's sake, again, each one of them was writing to a different audience for different reasons. Get a sense of what they were writing. Get a study Bible. Come to me and I'll recommend some. We have some resources in our library. What are our sources that are available to us so we can grow in our identity? What are they? Real quick. Bible, tradition and history, experience, reason, and community. Write those down at some point. Go on YouTube and then once you know them, don't just recite them. Bible, tradition, history, reason, experience, community. Engage these. We have resources. Come to me. I'll direct you to them. We begin to know who Jesus was. How do we know who Jesus was? We can go and look. We can look in the Bible. We can look at first century history. What were the circumstances surrounding Jesus? What were they anticipating in terms of Messiah? Who was disappointed with what he turned out to be? Who was really angry at him? Why did they crucify him? How did he make people so mad that they killed him? Capital punishment. Have you ever thought about that? He must have made somebody mad. Do we know anything about that, or are we still at the place where I confess my sins, I believe Jesus, I receive him in my heart, one day I'll go to heaven and be with the people I love? That's an important understanding. But we're not just believers in Jesus. We're followers of Jesus. So we want to know more about him. As we learn more about Jesus, and this is familiar language to a lot of you, as we learn more about Jesus, we learn who we are. We are children of God. Who is Jesus? Jesus is the Son of God. Jesus as the Son of God reveals to us who we are as sons and daughters of God. The more we know about Jesus, the more we know about God. The more we know about Jesus, the more we know about ourselves. Am I making sense? The more we know about Jesus, the more we know about others. The more we know about Jesus, the more we know how we are to engage our enemies. How did Jesus say to treat you? If someone strikes you on the right cheek, knock the mess out of them. Is that what he said? If your enemy takes something from you, what did he say? Sue him. What did he say? What do you say to do for those who despitefully use us? Pray for them. Bless them. How did he say we could strive for perfection? To love our enemies even as God loves us. Be ye therefore perfect, even as your father, your mother, your creator, your all in all is perfect. How? By striving for love. We were born for this. We were born for reconciliation, and there's no way in the world I'm going to have time to talk about that much other than to say this. Reconciliation is also a process. It's what Jesus came to do. The fall was primarily about relationships. We were created to be in relationship with God and one another in a perfect way. We were created for oneness. Oneness is not the sameness. Unity is not the same as uniformity. That's not what we're saying. We were created for oneness in the sense that we were created for wholeness. We were created for full peace, full purpose, full meaning, full joy. That's what we were created for. When something went awry, that's what went wrong. That's the gone wrongness of us. The relationships were broken. And so now Jesus came. If Jesus is the one who saves us, what do we need to be saved from? That which was broken, that which was lost. What needs to be restored? That which was lost. What was lost? Relationships. So Jesus came announcing the way to restored relationships. And this is minimally what is required. Everyone deserves justice. Justice. What is justice? Justice is what is due another. What is due another? Well, what does love require? That everyone is to be treated with respect. What does that mean? Respect literally means to look back or to regard. How many people walk through this world that no one even regards as a human being? Think about that. Think about the world in which we live. Think about this. How many times have you gone through a checkout register and forgot to even look up at the person who was there? Because we're becoming dehumanized in our society. One of the things that we need to recognize is that everyone needs to be regarded, to acknowledged as a child of God. Another thing that everyone is due is dignity. Dignity. The Latin word that comes from worth. If everyone is a child of God, how much worth does everyone have? Infinite worth. Think about those words. I know we use words, but when we're talking about worth, we're talking about value. What's another word? Something that is a treasure. Everyone is treasured in the eyes of God. Simply, because that person is a child of God. There is no meritocracy in the mind of God. God does not like some children more and some children less. In your mind, and I know some of us have been through some painful, painful experiences. Some of us now have enemies because of what they've done to us. This will be a healing process if we can accept it and receive it. God loves that person with an infinite love. God gives us the power to love with an infinite love. God does not cause all things, but God can cause all things to work for good. Forgiveness, there are new people here, I've said this before, but it bears repeating. Forgiveness is an act of the will before it is an experience of our emotions. We decide to forgive. And sometimes we decide again and again and again and again and again and again until we experience it. I promise you I would not say it. I have had some experiences that you wouldn't want to know about. You wouldn't. You'd want to say, keep that to yourself. I'm serious. It's one of those things people don't want to hear about. It was bad. I've had mess happen to me as a child and other times. Bad stuff. And I can honestly say to you, by the grace of God, cooperating with God, decisions over time, I have no ill will inside of me for any person. Now, I'm not saying, congratulations, Jacob. What I'm saying is, if you're in a place where you're harboring some pain and bitterness, I get it. I do. I promise you, I do. Make a decision. Make a decision to love. And that love will heal you as well. I'll leave that there. Justice means that everybody's treated with respect and dignity. Everyone is seen as an equal. Everyone is seen as an equal and everyone is free. That's the oneness of this community of faith. We don't agree on a lot of things. I've said a number of things this morning that more than half of you disagree with, and that's okay. You have the freedom to grow in your faith just like I have the freedom to grow in my faith as faithfully as we know how. We were born to be a reconciling community from within and to be a reconciling community from without. To be a presence in the world where everyone is treated with justice, everyone is treated with dignity, everyone is treated with respect, everyone is treated with equality, and everyone is treated with freedom. That's who we are called to be. That's what Jesus embodied. Now, here's something else I want us to know, because it's not just a social movement. This is, although as important as that is, in our love is our hope. This is not just a social vision, this is a personal vision. There are many this morning that are grieving for the loss of Laurie, and rightfully so. But our love, our faith in love, is also the source of our hope. Whatever we are going through, and we are all going to go through a season where we feel like we are being raked through the coals. Some of you are going through that season right now. Some of you are watching a loved one who's going through a terrible season. This is why it's important for us to know that when we grow in our faith, we are able to grow in our hope, and our hope is not wishful thinking. We can say in a way that is not a cliche, this too shall pass. And we will know that that is the truth. That is not a wish. This too shall pass. And there will come a day when all things are restored. Now, this is the beauty for you and for me. We become the mediators like Jesus temporarily. One of the beautiful things about the Protestant movement is that we became the priesthood of all believers. What does that mean? We all mediate God's love to one another. If you have faith, someone mediated that faith to you at some point. If you have love, someone mediated that love to you at some point. We can be the embodiment as Jesus was of that faith, of that hope, of that love, and that is our calling. I'm going to end on this note. In 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 18, we never need to miss this. All of this is from God, who reconciled us to himself through Christ. This is what I want us to know. Apart from God, we can do nothing. Apart from God, we can't breathe in and breathe out. Apart from God, we can't see who we are. Apart from God, we can't see who Jesus is. Apart from God, we cannot love one another as God has called us to love one another. Apart from God, we cannot forgive those people who hurt us. Apart from God, we can't know our meaning and purpose. But guess what? We're not apart from God. That door has been unlocked from the outside. All we have to do is walk out. My prayer for us this morning is that we will continue to be in the process of becoming, that we will recognize that we were born for this. We were born to know the love of God. We were born to know who Jesus is. We are born to know who we are. We are born to see others as God sees them. We are born to love our enemies just as God in Christ has loved us. We are born to treat this whole world with the dignity and the respect, the freedom, equality, and justice that they deserve. We are born to be free. That's my prayer for you, and that's my prayer for me this morning. I invite you to stand as you're able. I did a trick. I have a confession. I sped that clock up by 5 minutes, and it didn't help at all. If anyone here has never made a confession of faith, you're saying, I'm having an inkling that Jesus really is the one who embodies God's love. At one point, it seems strange or foreign or weird or scary. It doesn't have to. It just means that God loves you with an absolutely unconditional love, and you can believe Jesus when he tells you. If you're not a member of a community of faith, this is a welcoming community where we are growing in our becoming. We are growing in our love for one another, where we treat everyone with the love, the dignity, the respect that they deserve. I love that. Who wants what you deserve? We all want what we deserve. We deserve to be treated with infinite love. We deserve to be seen as children of God. If you want to be treated as a child of God, we're going to do our best to do it. When we fail, we'll come to you and ask forgiveness, and we'll try to make it right. Who is welcome here, church? Everyone is welcome. We all have an opportunity on this Sunday to recommit our lives intentionally to doing that for which we were born, to become the children of God we were created to be.
Wandered so aimless, life filled with sin. I wouldn't let my dear Savior in. Then Jesus came like a stranger in the night. Praise the Lord, I saw the light. I saw the light. I saw the light. No more darkness, no more night. Now I'm so happy.
Now may the love of God that surpasses all understanding, the love that surpasses our ability to comprehend it, the love that is surely real, the love that will set us free, the love we were born to know, may that love guard and sustain our hearts this day and forevermore. Amen.
I saw the light, I saw the light, no more darkness, no more night. Now I'm so happy, no sorrow inside.